Wayne Blake comes to speak us on the fatal error of the laying on the hands of the apostles of Christ. He's a graduate of Fried Hardeman University 92 and Spring Bible Institute 1998. I know some of you are wondering if, you know, if he can actually preach or is he just another pretty face. But he's preached for 12 years full-time and 20-some-odd years part-time, so he knows how to preach. It does not say in this little sketch here what you do currently. He works for the TDCJ. That has nothing to do with attention deficit syndrome or anything like that. It stands for the Texas Department of Criminal Justice.
And,
well, they let him out today, too. At least I think they let him out. I don't know. He may have escaped. I don't know. But anyway, we certainly appreciate having him. His wife, Laura, she's not here. But Jenna is. Jenna, the daughter, is here. And, of course, he's currently the Fish Hatchery Road Congregation. So, Wayne, come speak to us.
Yes, my daughter loves coming to these because she's not in public school today. She just loves that. No, she loves coming and seeing people as well as being able to joy. And always impresses me that no matter how distracted she looks, you could ask her a question about something and she can answer it. She's listening. I don't understand that, but she can pick it up. The 1:30 hour is probably one of the worst. You just ate. You're a little groggy, and you're expecting something. The build-up here is that I can preach, so you're expecting some good preaching. So we're going to hope that's going to fall into there, and that I will say some things maybe that will keep your minds focused on the purpose of what we're trying to do here. Yeah. The reason I don't put on my bio what I do is because anybody that works in IT, if you work in IT and people hear about that, it's just like a doctor. You're a doctor. Well, you know, instead of having a visit, what do? You go up to that doctor and say, you know, I got this little rash. Can you tell me what I need? Well, it's the same thing with PCs, and the people hear you work in PCs and things, and boy, next thing you know, you got all kind of things coming at you. Hey, what about this? What about that? And I'm going to tell you, PCs are just like doctors in this sense. The IT field is just like doctors. You have specialties. There is no way I can tell you everything there is to know about a PC and the problems it's going to have, because that would take me years and years and years and years of education. So I specialize in something. I don't really know what that is, but a lot of mine is self-taught. I didn't go to college to learn those things. My wife will be here tomorrow. She's working. It's hard for her to get off, and because of the surgery, she took a week off, and that put her about 3 months behind. So she's just scurrying around trying to get stuff done, but she will be here tomorrow. Everybody's asked me, is she going to be here? And I said, well, she's supposed to speak tomorrow, so I assume she'll be here tomorrow. If not, I guess y'all can just read the manuscript. We're looking at the idea or the error regarding laying on of hands. To me, this is an important topic, not just because I was asked to speak on it, but because just like all the topics that have been dealt with here today, we have people that are running around that are saying they're able to do the things the apostles can do. And one of them is the ability to lay hands on someone and heal them. And it's very interesting to me that whenever you get to looking at the apostles and the abilities that they were able to impart to others to do, there were things the apostles could do that other people can't do even with their laying on of hands. And we're going to get into some of that. I want to just kind of briefly mention, but, you know, they can strike people blind. They could kill them, cause them to die. There's a lot of things the apostles could do that common man couldn't do, even if he had gifts. So the apostles of the day, you hear about the positive. Oh, yeah, well, we're going to heal you. We're going to do all those kind of things. But what about the other things the apostles could do? You don't hear them doing those kinds of things. So as we get into that, we want to begin looking at how this term is used in the Old as well as in the New Testament. Particularly in the Old Testament, we look during the patriarch in the Mosaic time. A lot of times the laying on of hands was used in a miraculous way, but also in a non-miraculous way. Bestowing gifts on his grandsons, Jacob laid his hands on them in Genesis chapter 48. There was nothing miraculous about that. This was just the way that they imparted the idea that I'm setting you aside or giving you a particular thing, that would place their hands on them. During peace offerings or sin offerings or burnt offerings, in Leviticus chapter 8, verse 14, they would lay their hands on particular things. The priesthood, when they would set aside the priest to do their particular work, there was the laying on of hands, the idea of dividing them, separating them from that, as well as the prayers and things that will go about in Leviticus, Numbers chapter 8 and verse 12. The Day of Atonement by the high priest, you had the scapegoat, where he would literally put his hands upon the head of the goat and send it out. And that was symbolic in the sense that it was placing the sins of the people upon that goat, and then they would set it out into outside the camp, taking the sin, the guilt of the sins of the people. Then we look at Joshua, who was ordained for leadership. Hands were placed on him in Numbers chapter 27, verse 18 through 23. It says that he had already possessed the Spirit, but he was given the Spirit of wisdom. And this will be something I believe that would probably be in that same realm of the miraculous, in the sense that God gave him the ability to have a special type of wisdom to lead the people, to lead them the way God would want them to be led. And then in judgments, witnesses were to lay their hands on the blasphemer prior to his stoning him before he was put to death in Leviticus chapter 24. This could possibly be the idea of a sign of acceptance of the verdict that was placed upon that. And we get that allusion in the New Testament where it says, lay hands suddenly on no man. And the idea that by the placing of your hands on someone, it was a symbol that what I am saying is true, that this person is either good or they're doing evil. So don't lay your hands suddenly on anyone. Think it through. Make sure before you put your hands on them. And each one of these, this was a common practice that continued through the Old Testament. But in the New Testament, Jesus himself showed the laying on of hands often. When the little children would come to him, it says that he would place his hands on them and give them a blessing, pray for them. In healing people, Jairus' daughter was taken by the hand and healed in Matthew chapter 19, chapter 9. It says in Mark chapter 6 and verse 5 that a few sick came to Jesus and he placed his hands on them. A woman who was loosed of her infirmity of 18 years in Luke chapter 13. We're going to mention this, and we're going to get into it in a minute, but I just want to mention it because it's just showing some of the ways in the New Testament the laying on of hands was done. But the apostles were able to pass the ability to perform miracles, as was foretold by Jesus himself in Mark chapter 16, 15 and following, as well as in Acts 5, verse 12, and 28, verse 8. Ananias restored Saul's sight in Acts chapter 9 by putting his hand on him. It says, the scales fell from his eyes in chapter 9. Spiritual gifts themselves were imparted by the hands of the apostles, by the Samaritans, were mentioned specifically, the Ephesians, as well as Timothy. Acts chapter 8, chapter 19, 1 Timothy 4, and 2 Timothy 1. Those who were appointed particular service in Acts chapter 6, verse 1 and following, those men that were set aside to take care of the widows there who were, for lack of a better word, complaining that no one was taking care of them. Well, these men were set aside and their hands were placed upon them to deal with the work that needed to be done there. In Acts chapter 13, beginning of verse 1 through verse 3, we talk about Paul and Barnabas, how they were, the hands were placed on them to set them aside as they were about to go about the missionary work that they were involved in. This is just a list, maybe not of every instance, but it's just trying to give us various accounts that show through the Bible regarding the practice of laying on of hands. But now we want to go to Acts chapter 8, because this is where we're going to spend a lot of our time this hour or so, 35 minutes, whatever. Beginning of verse 5, it says, Philip went to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies, and that were lame and were healed. And there was great joy in that city. There was a certain man called Simon, who before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, This man is the great power of God. And to him they had regard, because that of a long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. And when they believed Philip's preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself baptized also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs that were done. Now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, Give me also this power, that on whosoever I lay my hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, Thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money, that thou hast neither lot nor part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. Then answered Simon and said, Pray ye to the Lord for me, that none of these things which you have spoken come unto me. And they, when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, returned to Jerusalem and preached the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans. Now, Philip the evangelist was doing as we all ought to do today, and that is preaching the word of God. But as he went, he was able to perform miracles. We see the purpose of that very clearly here. When he performed the miracles in front of the people, what did it do? It brought about faith in the people. And the things that he had said to them, preached to them, they were now ready to believe, to accept. Why? Because they realized that he was performing a miracle. And that brought them to him. Those who had good and honest hearts, they were willing to listen and obey the gospel. The Samaritans heard the gospel preached, they submitted to it, and they were baptized. However, a man named Simon, a former sorcerer, now a believer, and I do stress that because the Bible says that he was baptized. That's what the others did. If we hold to the view that Simon wasn't really baptized, wasn't really saved, then it would have to be the truth that the rest of the people that Philip preached to weren't saved either. I've heard that argument used. Some say, well, Simon really wasn't saved. Well, then the rest of the people weren't either. But they all obeyed. They did what Philip told them to do. And the scripture bears that out. He was used to being the one who came out to the people to make money. And with his sorcery, like a lot of the magicians and people who do sleight of hand today, he saw the apostles lay their hands on people, and they were able then to perform miracles. Boy, 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 he said, now, there's where the money is. There's where the money is. He realized then, he saw dollar signs. He knew the fame he had now, but boy, if he could do this, he would really be famous, infamous among the people. He was looking at his future and saying, boy, I've got it made now. But what was he told to do? Repent and pray. You know, the Bible's clear to the honest of heart that the apostles alone were given the ability to pass on the miraculous gifts to those whom they laid their hands on. In 1 Corinthians 12, verses 8 and 10, we are told there about the miracle, the gifts themselves. The gift of wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Everyone that the apostles would lay their hands on would get one of these gifts. The apostles alone were the only ones who had all these gifts, and others, as we will mention here in a few moments. But let's look at the gifts individually. The gift of wisdom. It would give that person divine insight, the ability to solve problems and have the ability to do so, defend the faith, resolve conflict, as well as to give advice, practical advice to those who were new in the faith. Stephen was a person that it says about him that he was given a particular type of wisdom because his adversaries were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke, chapter 6 of Acts and verse 10. So there was something in this wisdom that they were given that gave them the ability to give an answer to everything to the point where it would cause people just to shut their mouth because they didn't have anything else to ask. Because they'd have the answer. Knowledge would then allow a person to communicate information that had been divinely revealed. Paul spoke of revealing a mystery in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 51. That up to that point, as we know, the context is talking there about there are things that were revealed in the Old Testament that were still a mystery. They weren't ready to be revealed to those in the New Testament. But knowledge that God would give these people, they would be able to unravel those mysteries. In other words, teach people things that up to that point they may not have fully understood or even realized. Faith would be able to remove the difficulty in pursuing the will of God. You know, I looked all over the place and tried to understand this fully, what it meant to have the gift of faith. It's not easy to define that. They would be able to do great things from commands and promises of God and communicate such things to those who would listen to them. And the idea here is that in some sense, this would be a gift that would help to encourage other brethren to become more faithful. But I don't fully understand it. But that's what you get. There's a gift of faith. The healings would allow someone to be healed whole or raise them from the dead, as Jesus and his apostles. There wouldn't be any take two aspirin and call me in the morning. There would be no prescription given to someone. They had the ability to take one who was sick in whatever position of sickness they were and to instantaneously heal them. And it's interesting to me that it didn't require faith on behalf of the one who was being healed to receive this. What do you do with people that are dead and you bring them back to life? Did that dead person have faith? You know, when you think about it, that there were sometimes requests were made on behalf of someone else that they be healed. Not the person asking for it, but because of them asking for it, the other person was healed. So who had the faith there? Our modern day faith healers will say, well, the reason you weren't healed is because you didn't have enough faith. The Bible doesn't prescribe that. The faith is in the one who had the gift to impart that upon the person. Miracles would include the idea of casting out demons, changing matter from one form to another, raising the dead, exercising power over the elements. It's interesting to note that many of our modern day miracle workers, they cannot restore arms that were never there. They cannot restore legs. Boy, if we had people today that perform these type of miracles, think about what people going to war, what they would have to look forward to when they got back to the States. They wouldn't have to wear all these things, devices, to try to restore some semblance ability of mobility for them. But one thing I can say about it is they can relieve your bank account of that overburdened cash that you have in it. And they'll do that in a heartbeat. We have a lot of Simons out there. The dead are still dead, and they're filling up the cemeteries. And not one person who claims to be able to perform the same type of miracles is able to raise one of them from the dead. Prophecy would bring about the idea of direct revelation from God and imparting that on to the hearers. The Bible had not been written to this point. Therefore, they didn't have a book to go to like we do today, wherein would be written all of God's will that we need to know. So sometimes they would also predict future events. Think about the time before Paul went into the city and he was told, don't go, because if you go back to Jerusalem, something bad's going to happen to you there. What did he say? I've got to go. But he was told beforehand, prediction of future events. But other times they would reveal God's will in the here and now. The discerning of spirits, able to know whether a prophet of the other person was, whether another person was truly the prophet or who they thought they were, speaking by the Holy Spirit or by Satan. With this gift, they would have the ability to discern between an imposter and an opportunist. Peter himself was able to expose Simon for this very thing, as we read in Acts chapter 8. The gift of tongues, we know we've had lessons on this, the idea of being able to speak a language that you had no formal teaching in at all. And then the interpreter of tongues, the idea that that person would be able to take that tongue and to be able to explain it to you in whatever language that you needed it explained it in. So the idea here is that God would impart these things upon those who would obey the gospel, and their hands were placed upon them. So as we think about all this, then we realize that God gave them everything they needed. Everything they needed. You know, it's interesting to me that as we continue going through this, we begin to realize that when you look at the apostles and their ability to do the things they did, I put a section in here written by Brother McLish, and I believe that as far as the scriptures show that this is a true statement, and the idea that's correlated there is just simply this, is that the promise of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, from chapter 2 to chapter 5, only times you see people, seeing people doing miracles and things like that are of the apostles. But it is starting in chapter 6, beginning with Stephen and the others, that we see then more people then are having their hands laid on by the apostles. Now, this could be a lot of things. I kind of think of it like this. Up to this point, the church was there in Jerusalem. The people weren't out and about. They were there. So they wouldn't need to be able to have these gifts imparted into them because they would have those who were there, the apostles and things like that, that would be able to teach them everything they need to have, as well as men, the gospel teachers and others there. But as the church began to be persecuted and all, then it began to spread all over the world. The apostles couldn't go with each one of those and take off and go with them. So what would they do? They'd be able to give them the ability to reveal God's word everywhere they went. But as you look at the missionary journeys that are presented in chapter 13 and following, you see that as the apostles and all went through these cities, and then they would come back and appoint elders, lay their hands on people and things like this, that the gifts then began to be bestowed upon all the churches in some form or another. But what we see here is the Bible is clear that the apostles alone were able to do the imparting of the miracles by the laying on of their hands to others who had obeyed the gospel. Jesus had promised the apostles and the apostles alone that they would have this ability. And it's interesting to me that people now will say, well, we have this ability, and yet it was never given to anyone but the apostles. And it was only the ability to give those gifts to others by the placing of their hands, as we see in this Acts chapter 8. The gifts were given to the profit of the congregations to help them to grow and to mature in the faith as they would want. But as we see in Acts chapter 6, verses 1 and following, this is the first time we're told of someone doing signs and wonders that was after the apostles laid their hands on them and those that had been approved to serve the widows. The next occurrence of the laying on of hands after chapter 6 is chapter 8. And then again in Acts chapter 19, verses 1 and following. The apostle Paul himself baptized about a dozen men. And after laying hands on them, they were able to speak in other languages as well as to prophesy. But I want to go back to Acts chapter 8, begin at verse 21. It was said to Simon, "Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter." He wanted the ability to lay his hands on other people and impart these gifts. But he was told, you have neither lot nor part in this. Well, the idea of a lot, the part means simply a portion, or that is a province or a share or participation. Lot means by implication a portion, by extension an acquisition. In other words, he has no inheritance or no lot or no part in this thing. And it's kind of like I look at it like this. There are some things that my wife and I will discuss, and my daughter will walk up and say, "What are y'all talking about?" Try to be as nice as possible, but what you basically are what you say to her is, it's none of your business. You need to go on. Now that's, in essence, what Simon was told. What you're asking for, you don't even understand, first of all, what you're asking. And secondly, you have no part in this. What, the saving of souls? No. Performing miracles? No. The giving of the miracles to other people. The imparting of the miracles. And so if we look at it and understand that, then what are we talking about here? People today who say they have the ability to lay their hands on someone and give them the ability to be healed and all those kinds of things today, what are we saying? That when the apostles died, the ability to impart miracles died with them. That was always in God's plan. It was the promise that was given to the apostles. And they understood this because you see in their reply to Simon, you don't have lot or part in this. This is it for us to give you. Let's look at some of the things that we think about these miracles. You know, I look back and I thought about in the Old Testament, we think about Moses. Moses was given a rod that was going to be as a sign to the people when he went before Pharaoh. He was given the ability to put his hand in his up here and then he would pull it out and have a leprosy, then put it back in. He was given a set of miracles, the words that he was going to use as well as the plagues. And all of these were trying to prove to Pharaoh as well as those that were going through those that God is your creator. Look at the apostles. They had the nine signs, definitely, that they were able to impart upon others. But as I said before, we have it recorded in other places where the apostles also had other abilities also. In Acts chapter 19 and verse 11, we have there where there were special miracles that were done by the hands of Paul. In verse 12 of chapter 19, it says that he was able to send out handkerchiefs and aprons. And by the mere touching of them and putting them in, giving them to people, they were able to take it and give it to others and they would be healed. Eutychus in chapter 20 and verse 9, he was brought back to life by Paul. In chapter 13 of Acts, Elymas the sorcerer, in trying to keep the gospel being preached, he was struck blind. In Acts chapter 5, we all know this, and that in dealing with Ananias and Sapphira, as they lied to the Holy Spirit, what happened to them? They were instantaneously killed because they lied. And you began to look at these things and started looking behind the scenes and trying to understand what the scriptures give to us, particularly in Acts chapter 5, that when these things happened, what was the response of the people who heard about it? They were amazed. They were scared. They were not willing to do anything that would cause God, through the apostles, to do anything, do any harm to them. In 3 John chapter 9, verse 9, as well as in verse 10, not chapter 9, just verse 9 and 10, recorded forever, for all times, Diotrephes. And it says about him that I will remember him. That's John talking about when he comes to there. I don't know what John did to Diotrephes, but I guarantee you whatever it was, Diotrephes remembered John. You think about in 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 21, Paul writes, he says, do you want me to come with a rod or do you want me to come with love? I don't know about you, but I don't want whatever that rod signified when it talked about an apostle, because the apostle could strike you down. We have modern day apostles, so-called, people in our past. The first time I ever remember was Don Finto. I remember reading a lot of the Contend for the Faith, the old Contend for the Faith, and that was one of the first ones I remember as far as in the Lord's church who were apostate then, but they left and they came out saying they were an apostle. If you're an apostle, then do the works of an apostle. And if you can't do the works of an apostle, you're not a modern day apostle. The Bible tells us what an apostle was, told us what an apostle could do, what they were meant to do. And yet, we have people today who say they're all manner of things. Upon the apostles' death, as I said before, the ability to impart those gifts was done away with because we would have no new apostles. The reason we know this is because those who were apostles had certain qualifications that the scriptures themselves revealed to us. When they were going about trying to pick another apostle to add to the 11 after Judas had died, the qualifications they had was is that he had to be someone who was there at the beginning, who was there during the time of Christ, and who was there at the end, in other words, through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And they chose one. But the idea there is those were some of the qualifications they used to choose who was going to be there. And that's also going back to the idea we hear people today call themselves witnesses. If you go to the Bible and you read what a true witness was, first of all, they saw Jesus. I don't know anybody today who's ever seen Jesus. Got a lot of pictures of him out there. But nobody's ever seen him. So you can't be a true witness in the Bible sense of Jesus. The Bible tells us that an apostle had to be, as we said, be with Jesus in order to be a witness regarding who he was, the miracles, as well as the fulfillment of the scripture regarding him, his death, burial, and resurrection. You take those into account, then we have no apostles today. In fact, after the first century, we have no apostles since then. I put in my other manuscript, it's interesting how Muhammad is considered a prophet, but he's also considered an apostle in some of their eyes. And yet, he died by poisoning, and he couldn't do any of these miracles that the apostles could. In fact, he couldn't do miracles, period, but he couldn't do any of them that are listed here in the scriptures. You look around today and you hear all who can lay their hands on people and heal them. The ability of some to speak in tongues or prophesy or perform miracles is said to be happening even to this very day. The problem with this is simply they're fake. They're liars. Like Simon, they have no part or lot in this matter. The New Testament church has had to have miracles, signs, and wonders to confirm the words spoken to them by the apostles. In the church today, the need for laying on of hands on someone has ceased. There is certainly no need to lay hands on sacrifices as in the Old Testament. The sacrifices came to an end with the sacrifice of Christ. And the purpose of miracles and spiritual gifts has been fulfilled. That was to reveal and confirm the Word of God. And the gifts were designed to be temporary and therefore are not happening today. You know, we look at the Bible as we ought to. Not look to man and not look to man's doctrines, but to look to the Bible. And we see that the miracles, the signs, and wonders were given and used in the first century. And they were used for the purpose they were intended, but they never were intended to last in perpetuity, like a lot of people believe today. Upon the death of these apostles, the miracles slowly died away. Because only the apostles were given the ability to pass those gifts on. So there may have been some that lived after the apostles that still had gifts. But once they died, the miracles died with them. We see how God has had a plan for man to have access to these gifts after the Bible had no plan for man to have access to these gifts after the Bible was completely written. And that people today will not read the Bible, learn the treasures that it contains, come to a faith that will save by obedience to the contents of this book, then that man or woman will lose their soul. And those who teach that miracles and the laying on of hands are still in work today in this sense, as we have talked about today, they are teaching a doctrine that will cause people to lose their soul. And that's why we're here, to try to expose this, to get people to think about all of the things that we've talked about through this week. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Wayne. I have no doubt that most of us in attendance this afternoon know what the Bible teaches on the laying on of hands, but as Peter says, that it's a good thing to be reminded of that which we already know. So now that Wayne has finished telling us what we already know, buddy, we can lay hands on the old goat and send him out in the wilderness. Yeah, I really hate to be the one to conduct the first session in the afternoon, because you know you got things to tend to, and I don't know why it is that I have to be the only one to stay awake, but I did. So I again, Wayne, I appreciate you delivering this lesson, needful thing to be reminded of. We'll be dismissed again till the bottom of the hour, and we'll have our next speaker at that time.